ladies and gentlemen, I think the clock tells us very clearly it's time to start. So welcome to the August meeting of the Joint Strategic Commissioning Board. As the agenda said, I would remind everyone that this is a committee in common. Members will recall that the Council's Cabinet has given decision-making powers to its committee that meets here. However, because of its statutory functions, the CCG, the CCG members do not have the same delegated decision-making from its governing body. Therefore, when we reach areas for approval today, I will ask the Cabinet's committee, chaired by Chris Jones, to reach its decision about approval or not of the matter. And I will ask the CCG committee and myself to reach a recommendation, having considered the papers, to take to its governing body, which meets on the 11th of September. Is everyone clear about the process? It's the same as that previous bit. Okay, so on to the agenda. Apologies for absence. I know Mike Trahan, and I believe Lorna Quigley will be late because she's currently in an urgent meeting in Chester. Do we have any other apologies? Okay, so Councillor Mooney is on her way. Thank you, and your deputising room, thank you very much. Can I ask for any members' declaration of interest regarding the matters on this agenda?
Thank you, Sue. I work for CWP, so I'd like to recognise the interest.
Any other declarations relevant to this agenda? Thank you. So next we approve the accuracy of the minutes of the meeting held on the 19th of June, now which have been published on the council website in draft. Now I personally wasn't there, but the rest of you were, so I'm grateful for guidance on accuracy. So taking that through is page one. I wasn't there, but I think it should be Dr. Paul Cam rather than Ms. Paul Cam. Attendance. Thank you. Page two. Page three. Page four. Page five. Six, page seven, and page eight. Sorry, and then there's a little on page nine. Thank you. I therefore assume that those present are happy for me to sign this under.
So, members of the committee will be aware that this came to the last meeting where we discussed the draft commissioning and strategic commissioning and transformation plan of the local health and care. So, following the feedback that I received, and thank you everybody, it's been positive, some changes have been made to this, and some of that is just about reflecting some of the changes about our place-based care as well and our vision going forward. It's also, since it's been here, it's been the Health and Wellbeing Board, and only one slight change has happened as a result of that, which was just the inclusion of the public health reports and some of the local evidence. So just to remind members that this strategy is about our commissioning intentions really going forward. So we've joined the Adult Social Services, Wirral CCG and Public Health to look at how we can commission in a more cohesive manner for and improve outcomes for the population of Wirral. And this is setting out our intentions for the next 2 to 3 years. It's very much about place-based care, and I think the thing that I wanted to bring really to people's attention today is about our place-based care and about the 9 neighbourhoods that there's a lot more work in doing in this. In terms of the public, the only difference that will happen is that they'll start to see much more joined up and more proactive work, more preventative work. And we've worked a lot more with the voluntary and the third sector. So we've asked HUK alongside this have done some work asking in the neighbourhood what is it that's important to them in growing old on the rural. And some of that has also been reflected in this document now as well. So I think going forward, if the decision is to approve this today, we'll continue to work through those neighbourhoods on how to deliver these outcomes that we've developed alongside Age UK and the neighbourhoods and listening to people about what's important to them. I think if we go to page 23, it talks a bit more about the neighbourhoods, and this is about that we're not fundamentally changing services, but instead of services being delivered on what they concentrated on how they deliver their part of the pathway, we're going to be asking services to deliver the pathway in a cohesive manner. And that's what the task of the neighbourhood. And in the first year, we want them to look very much at the older population and the more frail population that we know are particularly in need on Wirral, and how we can help them to be more independent and to live at home as long as possible, minimising any time in the acute hospital, and if they have to go in, is to get them home as much as possible. So I think the only other thing I wanted to bring to attention today that's different from the last version is the outcome. So again, very much looking at the report that Age UK have done as a result of their talking to communities about what's important to them. We've looked at our outcomes, and they're very high level outcomes that you'll see. So there's about improving health and well-being, for example. And I think one of the things that's been key as a result of us joining as a commissioning outlook on how we deliver services is that we're not just looking at a medical model. So you see that some of the indicators there are looking at the loneliness. So, and that's one of the key things that we'll be asking the neighbourhoods next year when they're looking at the frailty in the older population. It's not just looking at the normal medical long-term condition indicators that we have, like rates of admission to hospital, things like that. They're also looking at that loneliness that isn't just pockets of deprivation that we always concentrate on, but looking at what does that mean to people. So very much looking at a more rounded approach to people, really, not looking at, well, that's your medical needs and you might have social needs or other needs, but looking at them in the whole, really. So that's what I just wanted to bring to people's attention today. So hopefully this is the final version today, just for them to be signed off today, and then it goes to our governing body in accordance, which is in a couple of weeks.
Thank you. Thanks, Nesta. Before I open it for comment, that's very helpful, can I ask you to touch on, as you have highlighted in your summary, under 6, how the engagement and consultation of this area will progress?
So again, very much working with our stakeholders across the whole of the services. So Age UK have been key in this really, and also with the neighbourhoods, using our the providers that we've got as well, so asking them, that so the staff, because I think sometimes when we've done engagement, we might not always ask the frontline staff that will know what it is like for people that are also receiving those services as well. And again, working with public health colleagues, with the community connectors, so there's a whole host of people and services that we've been able to access, and we'll continue to do so going forward, and asking people's views as well.
Okay, thank you. Andrew, sorry.
each of those work streams is going to be expected to demonstrate an engagement with the people using the services, the people working in the services, to deliver specific outcomes. So as this develops under the Health for All programme, which brings commissioners and services together with those who are providing the services, we should start to see some action plans and further commissioning plans developed specifically around the four, the six in the centre of that diagram, our primary work streams. The ones that are associated with that, such as methods optimisation, will also have to have planning schemes themselves. Essentially, we'll also demonstrate how they support the delivery of things like in plan care, 18-week referral to treatment times, in terms of learning abilities, improved access to housing, the greater support in the community for people with disabilities. So this is very much a vibrant, lively, moving document, and many of the plans will emerge as we go.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you, Chair. Well, Nesta, very much welcome this plan. I think that it truly is a joint plan. I know that myself and our people from local authority have had input as well as colleagues from the NHS. And I think this is our first set of commissioning intentions is very important in terms of setting out the way we hope to work. And I think that's particularly important because our key intention is to bring together what is quite a fragmented system of health and care, and to bring that together in a way that is moves away from competition and moves much more towards a system of collaboration and close working between partners at neighbourhood level. And I think that comes across strongly to me in the paper. Within the paper, as well as the Healthy Wirral objectives, which I think are very important objectives because that sets out our work programme, we also have a single set of outcomes, and those outcomes will enable us to work with all of our providers, whichever sector they're in, to focus very much on delivering better outcomes for the community of Wirral. I think that's absolutely our key focal point. And then finally, just to say that, again, the flavour throughout here that is very important from my perspective, is moving towards a system of personalised care, focused very much on what the individual needs, but also what local communities need at the neighbourhood level, as opposed to focusing on what the provider perspective in terms of what they can offer. So, just to say it's a lot.
Thank you. Ben,
I think firstly I need to play a little bit of an interest in because I work for aged UK. I'm sorry I wasn't here at the beginning, but I have nothing to do with the commission and the movement of Stuart, so although I actually work for them and don't know anything to do with the commission and this programme, although I did attend the neighbourhood meetings. I believe in targeting care where it's needed because especially with older people, because that's what I specialise in, the people in Egremont, the older people in Egremont are completely different needs to the people in Heswell, the older people in Heswell. So I do believe in targeting certain care in certain areas. And I do welcome us all working together because I think all working together will provide a better level of care for people. What I am concerned about and what I will be concerned about, what I will hopefully try to keep an eye on, is where this integration is and people aren't getting the access to acute care that they need. So the boundaries cannot be sort of muddled up. The people need medical care, the third sector cannot be put in as a replacement for that. And I think, although our welcome is all working together, and I think there's a real benefit for people that's all working together. As I mean yesterday with the fire services, we with aged care work very closely with the fire services. They apply to people's houses, they put in fire alarms, but they quite often refer into aged care because they need benefit checks or because they need befriending or because they need whatever. So the third sector have got a really good place in finding people who may not come to the fore normally. So there's an awful lot here I welcome. There are some concerns as well, and I think as it develops, maybe their concerns will go, but we will be keeping sort of really close eye on making sure that the lines of where people's responsibilities are not muddied and that we know that people are getting the care that they need and the support that they need.
Is it on that point?
Yeah.
Can I just allow us to remind them yourself, Julie?
So thank you for that. absolutely see your, you know, why those concerns would be there. And I think just to assure you is that, you know, that the aim of this is to make sure that people can access that, that the voluntary sector. And one of the things that's come out in the neighbourhood meetings with the GP coordinator leads that we've been having is that people are not aware of what's available in their community. And we've been working with councillors to, you know, to look at how we can tap into those, all of the assets, as they're called, but, you know, all of that richness that we've got. And I think when it comes to, I think what saddens me is when a qualified person is trying to do something that actually they shouldn't be doing that. We should be asking the third sector to do. So I think it goes, you know, on the other side, whereas, you know, somebody that's qualified is saying, well, I'll do that for you, and actually we could ask somebody like the AGK or another organisation who's far better equipped to do that, and absolutely neither can they then be asked to do things that are statutory responsibility. So yes, I think you're right, and I think we need to be cognizant of it moving in either direction.
Thank you. Julie, can I ask the hands go up? Julie, this is your turn next.
I was just wondering, just to mention that, is there anything that we can start doing some sort of management system on making sure that people with medical needs are met? Will we be monitoring exactly what the third sector are doing, exactly what the public health are doing, exactly what the NHS are doing, so that the boundaries and the lines are very clear to see? So, yes. The monitoring system used.
Julie, sorry, I've been waiting.
Thanks, Chair. I think my comment was that I really welcome the opportunity that we've got now to actually bring commissioning together, which from my perspective was fragmented in 2013. I enjoy working with council, please don't complain, but we commission a lot, through public health, we commission a lot of medical services, so actually to be part of a commissioning strategy like this, putting the fragmentation back together and creating a whole is a real opportunity, I think, and one that I welcome. I think the other thing for me, it builds on the conversation that Nesta and Bernie were just having, is I think the challenge is for us to make sure that this doesn't become a medical model of health with a pure focus on the NHS and what the NHS does. It's about how do we connect the NHS into what's happening in our communities and neighbourhoods. And I think that's a real challenge that we keep having to ask of ourselves to make sure that we create something that other people want and that it's very much based on where they live.
Chris. Thank you, Sue. I just want to thank Nesta for making the changes following the comments at the last meeting. I think it's been really helpful. I think this paper absolutely sets out the challenges and the huge opportunity that it gives us for the CCG and for the council, and I think public health is taking such a big role in that now as well, which really, really pleases me. We are, as a board, have made the commitment to speak to people and to providers to give us the best services we can to get better outcomes. And I think, you know, we just need to stick with that. I think it's really exciting. It's transformational. I think the Age UK survey really showed that in the 9 areas, there were 9 different priorities, which was actually surprising to me because I thought that there would have been a lot more similarities. So I think it's really important that we look at people. But this place-based care has got to be good because it's got to give local people what they really want to need. Any other comments?
Can I just ask the extent to which the main providers of health and care services have indicated engagement with, for example, the outcome measures, which I think now we've got them very clearly measurable. Are they giving positive indications of their intent to work with us in driving those areas of performance change?
The simple answer is yes, Alan, they have. As Nesta was doing the work around this strategy and the outcomes framework, there's been a lot of positive engagement from our enterprises, both through the defined Cheshire Rural Partnership Trust, Wirral Hospitals, Wirral Community. ask. So there's a lot of work that goes on around this, and it's not just on the strategy. We've got lots of times has been done through Graham's oversight, through the neighbourhood teams, through the AE delivery board for the urgent care piece, and then with Jason and others in terms of the learning disabilities part of the work. So there's been a lot of work over a considerable period of time on this, and now it's about making sure it's actually taken into action through how we specify services and pathways we wish to have in place, and just really then the experience of the people who use the services as well, because they now want to see these services are joined up in the delivery.
Any other comments or questions about it? Paul?
It's just more a comment than a query. As a GP working around for the past 15 years, I welcome the development of the integration and transformational plan. I think that the style of working that we've experienced as clinicians has to change, and this is a really exciting time for us in the delivery of health and care. And I've become increasingly aware of, when I'm talking about delivery of health, that it's health and care, and more stressing the benefits of using the third sector in terms of delivering support for patients and for our population, but also being very mindful and burning out my end, what you say, being very mindful about ensuring that where there are urgent needs, they are met in an appropriate and timely fashion, and where there are more social needs, that we utilise the skills and the real benefit that we have here in Wales of over 1,000 third sector organisations.
1,000.
Yeah, over 1,000 third sector organisations. The more and more I talk to clinicians, when I say clinicians, I don't mean just doctors, I mean healthcare professionals across the world, engaging with them and encouraging use of Age UK and all the other organisations has been met very positively. And as you can't open the newspapers nowadays without hearing how stretched the NHS is, and actually this is a really useful and really positive step forward in terms of utilising all the skills to avoid that stretch and to really get the best out of what we can do.
Thank you. I don't see any further hands up. So, first of all, thank you to Nesta. I know this has been a huge piece of work. Thank you to everybody, because this has been seen in a number of places, and very helpful input has come from many sources to make it document it is now. But a lot of hard work by Nesta and her team. Thank you. So, the recommendation is that we are asked to adopt the revised strategy. So, referring back to where we were to explain at the start of the meeting, I'd ask that Chris discuss with the councillors and sort the vote on approval, and that I will then seek the decision of the CCG members to recommendation to take to governing body.
Councillors, are you happy to accept the revised commission and transformation strategy?
Yes.
Yes, all agreed. Thank you.
Thank you. Governing body members, are we happy to recommend it to governing body on the 11th of September?
Yes.
Thank you. Mr. Duffy, happy.
Thank you.
Then I might switch that off. Okay, so now move to the All Age Disability and Mental Health, which is page 35 of your pack. And I believe it's Jason who's leading on this one, is that right?
Thank you, Chair. So this follows on quite nicely from the last agenda item around integration and joint commission arrangements. This report is to describe the creation of an all-age disability and mental health service, which very much meets the objectives of Rural Health and Care Commissioning, the Healthy Rural Programme, the All-Age Disability Strategy and the Rural Employment Pledges. This service has been under design amount of time. I was based on the improving services following what people told us. So integrating assessments, case management and support planning processes for children and adults with disabilities and with mental health needs with Cheshire and Wirral Partnership Trust will improve support for most vulnerable people in Wirral who have a disability or mental health need. People with disabilities and their families have told us that they've experienced difficulty in navigating between different services and between health and care organisations. They found it difficult to maintain communication with all the different people involved in their care, and they've not always received and experienced joint care planning for moving into adulthood and receiving services in adulthood. So this service aims to ensure that the council and NHS partners use our collective resources to provide better and more joined-up support for people. And it follows the successful implementation of a similar integrated service for older people, which was created with the NHS Community Foundation just over a year ago. Wirral Council's Cabinet in March 2016 approved the establishment of the Transformation Programme to create an online disability mental health service. And in November 2017, Cabinet approved the full business case with the requirement that final arrangements come back in spring of 2018 for the final arrangements to be signed off. Further work was required around the aspects of child protection and children's safeguarding, which meant that we brought final arrangements for approval in July and August this year. Now, CWP Board have approved the final business case on the 25th of July, and a leader decision has been made on the final arrangements, to approve the final arrangements, and for this Joint Strategic Commissioning Board to endorse that decision. In terms of setting this service up, there are a number of key features. We consulted with the staff involved, and that included the GP transfer of 142 posts, which included 20 vacancies, GP transferring from the Council's employment to the employment of Cheshire and Wirral Partnership Trust. The contract arrangements are in the pack and supported by a significant detailed contract and service specification. The contract vehicle is a Section 75 arrangement, which lasts up to 5 years. The care budget itself isn't transferred to the Cheshire and Wirral Partnership Trust. That's retained as a board budget with Wirral Health and Care Commissioners, and Cheshire and Wirral Partnership draw down against that board budget to meet assessed needs through their case management arrangements. The staff that transfer remain in the local government pension scheme, and that was a key feature of our consultation and was a very important factor for the council to make sure that staff retained their local government pension membership. In terms of cost of setting the service up, there have been some costs, as one might imagine, in setting the service up. There are support functions which are listed on page 6 of the report, and they total about £155,000. There are one-off setup costs that total just over £140,000, which we agreed to share that cost with Cheshire and Wirral Partnership Trust on a 50-50 basis. And of course, there is an additional pension cost due to the requirements for employers.
huge amount of work in that, which thank you very much, and very detailed documents that were very helpful to read. Can I open it to comments or questions by members? Paul, then Bear.
It's just a comment for me. It would have been a lot easier not to do this. And the reason why it's being done is because this is in the best interest of families and their children. So there's a huge amount of work that's gone into the detail, and with some resistance as well. But it's the right thing to do, so I fully support and I'd like to bring on my James and others to get this off the ground.
Thanks, Paul. Bernie
and
Sam.
Two things really.
So, in relation to the statutory functions, absolutely right, not all of the statutory functions can be delegated. When we're describing delegated functions, the statutory director for adult services and the statutory director for children's services retain the statutory duties within the council. It's the actual functions of delivering those activities that's been delegated under contract, but the statutory duty does remain firmly with the council for both the adults and the children's part. Additionally, there are some very specific areas that can't transfer. So, for example, the approvals and reapprovals of the advanced mental health professionals is a function that the council can't delegate, so we will retain and oversee that. We had a lot of discussion and a huge amount of consultation around the child protection functions, and we considered various options on those. And what we came to in the end, through consultation with the staff involved in transfer, but also departmentally, what we got to was that the functions supporting the child protection arrangements would be carried out by the skilled professionals that are transferring, where it's related to their particular casework with those individuals. But the decision making on child protection would remain firmly in the council, and that process would be supported by a very rigorous professional support offer from the children's principal social worker in a similar fashion to the adult principal social worker function. So absolutely, it's a little bit of a mix, but I hope that clarifies. If I just move on to the trade union issue, we've been consulting with staff since December last year on this specific transfer with all of the staff that are involved in the transfer. We've actually been engaging with trade unions probably about 3 years on this, because we've been through the consultation process with the staff cohort that transferred to the Community Foundation since last year. So trade unions are very versed in this and are very supportive of the principle and of the reasons why we're doing this. The lengthy staff consultation this time enabled some really robust and thorough discussion with our staff group. And I can honestly hand on heart say that the service target operating model and service specification were significantly changed as a result of the consultation with the staff. And some of the arrangements are direct results of those conversations with staff and trade unions. So trade unions, we had our closing meeting for the consultation recently, and they are satisfied and supportive of the outcome.
Thanks, Jason.
Again, thank you, Jason and Graham as well, and others for the work they've done on this. It does follow the trend that we've pursued in terms of the community services transferring to the community trust and envision the council, and that is most welcome and service, they're demolishing the outcomes, demolishing the contract, they hold true to the principles and guiding vision of this, about person-centred care, and about making sure people with disabilities live more independently, people have healthy, aligned, vulnerable children, because the potential of those services is joined up and accessible. That's our job as commissioners. We're still doing that work with the Community Trust a year on. We're now starting in terms of the work with CWP. So I absolutely fully endorse the recommendations of the board.
Any further comments, questions? Thank you. Now, we do have specific recommendations. Now, on going through this in detail, I considered and checked with our Director of Corporate Affairs that this is primarily a council statutory duty. Therefore, I would actually suggest that the CCG members could make a comment and their thoughts about endorsement, but the actual endorsement should be by the council members, not by taking recommendations to the CCG.
Everybody make a call that.
So, shall I do that way round? I ask the CCG members whether we would be happy to recommend to our council colleagues that they consider endorsing.
Yes.
But that's just a recommendation. Decision's yours. Councillors, are you happy to accept the recommendations on page 38 as they stand? Thanks very much to Jason and his team for a huge amount of work on that. As Ben said, we look forward to hearing further about it. So, item 6 is the Care and Support at Home Commission, which starts on page 375. I know you're Joseph, that the lead officer is Jane Marshall, and then Stuart, I understand Jane to be unavailable, so thank you very much, Jackie Evans, for coming. So,
Jackie and Ian. Thank you. Thank you, Chair. And so, yes, Ian and I are going to talk to the people who are going to join us. Thank you, Chair. I'm Ian Stewart, Assistant Director for Brand and Care and Partnerships at the CCG. I'm co-author of this proposal around a joint commission for care and support at home. So we're again all talking about here, also in care for patients. It's the first one we've first launched, integrated commissions that we've pulled together as a council and the CCG. It is about actually improving the sustainability of the domiciliary care markets out there for our patients and clients. The commission recognises support as a continuing trend in long-term residential nurse replacements, reducing, so we need to grow the offer from the community to help people remain at home for as long as they can, independent as often they can. So domiciliary care provision is key in that sense. The commission will include what we refer to as top to bottom, that the everything, so it includes this commission, reablement services, domiciliary care services, complex and continuing health care, domiciliary care and end-of-life care. So it's a full total market commission that we wish to move onwards. It will include a newly designed integrated pathway to ensure that, you know, again, we're going to have clients dropping through gaps because we commissioned an integrated service for domiciliary care, and that we need it all joined up. We need the agencies, particularly things like the continuing healthcare nurses on the CCG side, absolutely understanding the correct pathway for patients and clients to access care. There will be a focus on hospital admissions avoidance, so a responsive domiciliary care market to help the hospital discharge process where we can. There's key components of monitoring the paper, I won't list all of them, I did just want to pull out three. One aspect would be social value, and building into the evaluation criteria for the procurement a social value based on 20%, which is probably the highest we can get to. But it's a real focus on wanting to keep Wirral sustainable good social value component to this commission. The other one I wanted to mention was open book accounting for the accountants in the room. It's a real exploration with providers to really understand their costs. And as a health commission side, we don't routinely do this, so I'm really excited that we explore this with the market through this commission to really understand the costs and the real costs of the providers for providing care, to then understand that the budget we've got is the correct way, and that any efficiencies within that budget are actually identified and be able to reuse and reinvest in more service. So that's a key component. Place-based care has been mentioned, so again, we've had several workshops over 6 months or so with a range of consultancy care providers currently, and explain the place-based, the neighbourhood model that we're moving ahead with. And we're clear with this commission that the solution we want next April from the consultancy care markets is to be integrated and blended into delivery through the nine neighbourhoods, if we can, and then more level of four parliamentary constituencies. So a real focus in terms of that model of delivery. The Whittle 2020 plan does include a target to support local businesses to thrive and do well, so again, just reinforces our approach on the social value component to this procurement. There are a series of recommendations. Before we get to that, I just wanted to finish on my final brief point, which was the suggested contract term for this commission is 5 years plus three, plus one, and ultimately 10 years ultimately. And the rationale behind that is just sustainability and stability for the market. So a 5 year contract in the first instance with their options to go to a further three and then a further one and a further one. Clearly, with any contracting route, we have break clauses in, so if it doesn't really work out, break clauses where you can change the contract. But the intention is that whoever secures this, they have a stable 5 year contract with options of plus three and a further 2 years beyond that. There are a series of recommendations in the paper that more has to consider. Predominantly, it's around allocating and sensing use of a pool budget. So, bear in mind, this is one of the biggest probably integrated commissions in the region of 12 million, maybe up to £15 million worth of public service money when pooled. So consider the sanction of pooling the budget resources to fund this commission. Agree to develop a proposal of a centralised system for commissioning, and that's just around, at the moment, as you can